Order. First, ask Mr. Stonecipher to do the invocation for us, please.
Lord, we thank you today for another wonderful day on earth. We thank you for this group of people that you brought together who care so much about education in our state and the future and and where we're going here at St. Pete College. I ask that you give us all patience, that you give us all grace and understanding. We ask, Lord, that you would give us the wisdom to make the right decisions to move this college forward. We ask also for your discernment. It's in your wonderful name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
I pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
Thank you. Preliminary matters, don't see any
there
retirement
are none.
Resolutions on for today, so recognition and announcements. Clearwater Campus Partnership with the Helen Gordon Davis Center for Women, Dr. Vitito.
You know, Mr. Chairman, if we might, Ann Madsen is the representative for that, and she called to say she's stuck on the bridge in traffic. Could we ask your blessing to just slot her in when,
sure,
when occasion? Thank you, okay?
Sure. Moving into comments, I have no comments this morning. Any comments from board members?
I have one.
Sure.
My law partner, his son is a pitcher at Daytona State, and they played a home-and-home against St. Petersburg College, the men's baseball team. And according to my partner, Daytona State got smoked by St. Pete College. And he wanted me to make sure that everybody within the sound of my voice knew how outstanding the men's baseball team is for St. Petersburg College and what a classy group of young men that take the field. So, Dr. Law, if you'll pass that along to the men and the head coach, that would be great.
Thank you very much. Thank you. Nice to share that. Thank you.
Dr. Law, any comments?
I have a couple that I'd like to share. On as we adjourned last month, the board asked me to reestablish contact with former trustee Bridget Bellow and former trustee Bob Fine to invite them to join us for some recognition. We've been able to secure Bridget's visit to the board next month in April. And Bob, we're still working on a convenient date, but we've been dutiful trying to chase them down. They are both sad and I think probably at 9 o'clock on Tuesday morning happy. Okay, so thank you very much. The other is all of you should have received yesterday a copy of the operational audit for the college. There were I think to say that there were virtually no there were certainly no findings of any consequence. What happens is the Auditor General's staff, as they find things at any of the colleges, they add them to the audit list going around. So the one item on timesheets, 2 or 3 years ago, they had told us we had to have A&P, the administrative and professional people, even though they're salaried, we had to do timesheets. We did that. We sign off on them dutifully. There are a couple of exempt career people who should also have their timesheets approved. So that's what they had discovered. The stuff on the IT is really improved best practice that they're talking about, and they've really raised their game on providing guidance to us on what are the best practices. No security findings, nothing of deep concern. Our guys do a great job. We will adopt what they had suggested for us. I have to say, I think for $150 million organization with several thousand employees, who knows how many transactions the auditors review. I'm quite proud of the work that the staff does to not just get the columns lined up, but to represent the expenditure of public funds in the best possible way. I was delighted with the audit. If you're expecting better than that, you'll need to express that now, because we might be at our high water mark on that one. Thank you.
Is that all?
Yes.
I don't have any comment card, so we'll move into review and approval of the minutes. The minutes of the last board meeting are in everybody's packet. I'll take a motion unless there's any changes.
So moved unless there's changes.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? Motion passes. Monthly reports. Joe, anything from you this morning?
Nothing to report this morning.
Good.
Thank you.
Suzanne, anything?
Yes, I do have a report. I'm very pleased to introduce the college's new Associate General Counsel, Mr. Mark St. Louis, and I'm going to ask him to join me at the podium. So, Mr. Mark St. Louis is joining us from New College of Florida, where he has served as the General Counsel for the last 3 years. Prior to that, he worked assisting the coordination of Stetson College of Law's Center for Higher Education and Law and Policy. But he's no stranger to St. Petersburg College, having worked here in the Human Resources Department prior to going to law school full-time in 2009. He's also worked with the Michigan Army National Guard, where he served as a Human Resources Specialist, processing deploying service members in Operation Iraqi Freedom. Mark has a bachelor's from Michigan State University in political theory and constitutional democracy. He has an MBA from Baker College, and he has his law degree from Stetson University College of Law. He has to go off to work today, but he starts with us on Monday morning. We're very pleased, and welcome, Mark.
Thank you.
Would you like to?
Sure. I'm very excited to start, and I'm very happy to be back at St. Petersburg College. So I'm looking forward to working with all of you.
Mark, thanks.
Thank you.
The Foundation's annual update, Mr. McLeod, Ms. New.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman, members of the board, and Dr. Law. We are so pleased to be here this morning to present the St. Petersburg College Foundation's fiscal year-end report, and I'm even more pleased to introduce the chairman of the Foundation Board of Directors, Mr. Bill McLeod. I will be speaking to the first few slides and then hand it over to Mr. McLeod. As we look at our financial assets, and let me start by saying that the foundation is on a fiscal year end March 31st, so these are some preliminary numbers, but we feel pretty good about them. Beginning in 2011, at this 6 year at a glance, we had $46 million in assets compared to $61 million today, an increase of $15 million over 6 years. And this funding represents primarily our permanently and temporarily restricted funding. Permanently restricted funding is our endowment fund. These are gifts that are made to the foundation with an intent connected to them. Their spending each year is only a portion of the earnings. Where temporarily restricted funding are gifts that, again, were made with a specific purpose in mind, but the restriction does not then also relate to the spending each year. We also have non-cash assets. The primary one is our foundation art collection at an estimated value of $25 million. Looking at our annual revenues, again over the 6 year period, in 2011 we brought in just over $1 million compared to $2.1 million this year, a 97% increase. And we are very pleased to report that over this period we have generated over $10 million. And this is in great part to the work of the Foundation Board of Directors, the Foundation team, the vision of the President, the Deans, the Provost, the faculty and staff. And we're very fortunate to have those partnerships that then enable us to raise this kind of money. Donors and contributions. To make the distinction, donors are individuals, businesses, organizations, and contributions are the gifts they give. Oftentimes, and we really like it when they give more than one gift a year. In 2011, we had 515 donors. This year so far, we have 1,146 donors. For contributions, we started with 610, this chart shows a starting point of 610 contributions in 2011. And so far, and like I said, we're still counting, we have 1,210 so far in 2016. As I referenced earlier, each contribution has an objective. We have seen philanthropy become so much more sophisticated over the last 10 or 12 years. And at this foundation, by far, the most important aspect of what we do are scholarships. About 59.9 and a little bit better than that of the money we receive goes to scholarships. 34% supports programs, and that includes our Innovation Grant Fund, Women on the Way, Men Achieving Excellence. We receive another 6% for fairs and forums, and this would include the foundation's annual speakers event, other college events like the business plan and elevator pitch competition. And we receive a little less than 1% in unrestricted funding. Contribution size. Our goal is to increase not only the number of contributions, but the size of contributions. And we know this is a great deal of work over a period of time. It is rare that that million-dollar gift falls from the sky. It's generally a history of giving, cultivation with that donor, and engagement. We have increased the size of our contributions. We received in 2011 78 gifts of $1,000 or more. This year we're working on 186 gifts of $1,000 or more, and we look to increase, to continue to increase that number. Our scholarship initiative. Pardon me. We have several scholarships that we oversee, the largest of which is our traditional scholarship program. The first two rows here are for comparative purposes, our traditional scholarships, and these numbers are reported on an academic year versus the numbers I spoke about earlier that were reported on a fiscal year. For our traditional scholarships, we received almost 3,000 completed applications last year. About a third of those were from new applications from students who applied for the first time. The foundation has put several things in place where we're doing more student outreach to let our students know the opportunities that are available to them. We awarded over 1,500 students scholarships. The average award was $709 for a total of more than $1.4 million in traditional scholarships to our students last academic year. That compares to just over $1 million the year before. Our achievement awards, these have been with the foundation for a long time. It's not something we actively market anymore, but these are awards that go to students who are getting ready to graduate, either 2 years or 4 year students. The awards can be anywhere from $100 to $1,000. The average award last academic year was $413 for total awards of just under $44,000. Our presidential scholarships, last year the foundation worked with several other departments in the college to revamp the Presidential Scholarship Initiative. The idea under the vision of the president was that this should be really a marketing effort to attract the best and the brightest graduating high school seniors in Pinellas County. And we have done that. Last year, we over-awarded a little bit. We awarded 65 scholarships. These are full tuition scholarships with a value of just over $6,600 for a total award of $432,000. And these are the creme de la creme. They have a GPA, an average GPA of 1120, an average SAT of 1120, and a GPA of 4.2. So we're very proud of that initiative. And finally, our First Generation Scholarship Fund. This is the only program that the state continues to match dollar for dollar. And the way this works, each year the state will send us a guarantee match. So the foundation goes out and raises the money. Last year it was $86,000. So we go out $86,000 and a little bit more than that, because if a college does not meet their goal, those dollars are then distributed among the colleges that surpass the goal. We apply for the match. Then we send our money and the match to our financial assistance department that then makes those awards. Last year on the $86,000, we raised over $91,000 for a total award of $183,000. And this year, the good news is we surpassed it again, and the total amount will be $210,000. So we're very pleased with that. In all, the foundation oversaw the awarding of over $2 million last year. And we're very pleased to report those numbers to you this morning. With that, I will turn it over to the chairman of the foundation board, Mr. McLeod.
Real quick, before you leave, if I could, is the gender disparity typical?
It pretty much reflects where we are at the college. We're a little bit heavier on female, but I think that's pretty close to where we are, the breakdown on the college.
Wow.
Is that right, Dr. Law?
Yeah, the profile is 60-40, and the 40 is getting smaller, the 60 is getting larger. Clearly, the women students are much more diligent in going through the process, though, paying attention, getting things in on time, getting going. So that doesn't surprise me a great deal. I mean, the presidential scholars are 70-30, and we do those by sending letters to the local high school students. I mean, that's not an application process, really. Those are where students fall in their GPA in high school.
Wow. So
that is what we are dealing with, Mr. Foster. Good catch.
If the board looked like the student population, two of us wouldn't be here. Need a lot more Laurel Lees.
Ms. Francis, are those, we're giving scholarships, are those 2 year or 4 years?
They're awarded on an annual basis, so they can reapply every year.
Okay.
The presidential scholarship is for 60 credits, so a student knows they have 60 credits of support, essentially a 2 year support.
Okay.
Yes, so the presidential is 60 credit hours. We used to award them by term, but the idea was to give the student an idea of what they could plan on, so we try to do as many as we can on an annual basis.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman. I am pleased to be able to speak to this honorable board. And I bring you greetings from our board of directors for the foundation. We're excited about what we've done and the future of where we're going. And of course, we're very pleased to know that if you don't have a plan, you plan to fail. So we put together a strategic plan that I can say was very interactive with our board members, and they were excited about it. And we had planned a certain time, and it elapsed that time, and I had to really push them out. We had them here, had the strategic planning meeting here at the lab, and it went extremely well. Out of that, we put together some priorities and strategies that we are very, very excited about and have achieved a lot of those priorities, and it was a 2 year plan that we wanted to put together. And I'm an old engineer from the military, and we look at the six P's: poor prior planning, produce poor projects. And so we needed to have a plan. We have that plan, and we're excited about the future. My chairmanship will end in April. We have a capable replacement that I know will continue to carry on that. We wanted to take a look at a couple things. Our governance committee, who works to select and recommend candidates for the board, that is critical to us. We believe that we have to have the right people on the board with the right mindset for the goals and mission of the foundation. And we are very pleased that our governance committee have worked very diligently to do that. And we've brought on some simply outstanding people to be part of the board. The other part of our strategy was our development committee, because we need to have that focus on some of the larger donors that we're going to reach for in the community to help us grow. And so I've asked Mr. Sherman to chair that committee, and he's doing Ken Sherman, he's doing a wonderful job. And the governance committee, Mr. Steve Shepherd, is doing a wonderful job on that committee. And I want to publicly thank our foundation staff. Vice President New and her team have been simply outstanding in supporting the foundation. And we could not have achieved these things without her. I just think that it is so important that we continue to have the foundation board be part of your vision in terms of what we can bring to the trustees and assisting you in your mission. And as we say, if we're not at the table, we may be on the menu. So we want to make sure we're at the table and we're beginning to do those things. But I would like to have Francis now take you through a couple of our strategic priorities that we had in place, and then I will close with you.
Thank you. Mr. McLeod already referenced the Development Committee. Ken Shervin is the chair of that. Their focus is to really expand gift size, expand our business partnerships and our access to high net worth individuals. They have talked about, in one of our projects this year, will be to develop a fundable projects portfolio that will align with the college's work and mission, that will include some naming opportunities for some of our current projects. One of the other strategic priorities was our annual speaker series, which we launched last year. Some of you will remember that our first annual featured Apple co-founder Steve Wozniak and was quite successful. And the whole idea behind this was to bring in a speaker with wide appeal to attract audience members that might not otherwise attend a college event. And I think we succeeded that last year, and we're currently looking at our speaker for this year, so I'll keep you posted on that. And this event generates support for our first generation scholarships. Our Alumni Association, about a year and a half ago, the Alumni Association came under the umbrella of the foundation, and since that time we've really been able to work together and work as a team. We realized that there was never a membership appeal. There was never, for those wonderful alumni that sent in their $15 a year, there was never a renewal appeal. So we have done that. In fact, the week before we went on break, we received a renewal from a man who had sent in his $15 for his Alumni Association membership back in 1997 and now has renewed. So we're very proud with those small stories, but they are very meaningful in the big picture. We've purchased new software and members that create new membership cards, and the association continues to do some of the good work they've done for a number of years, including selecting our outstanding alumnus for 2016. It will be Congressman Gus Bilirakis. They also award two additional scholarships, the Apollo Scholarship for a graduating two-year student and the Achievement Scholarship, and these are for graduating four-year student, and those are $2,500 scholarships. And this year we also launched the Alumni Connections newsletter that specifically talks about events and happenings at the college to hopefully engage our alumni that may have graduated last year or may have graduated many, many years ago, to help them become more engaged with the college.
And I tell you, we would not, I know I couldn't have achieved my life efforts had not I attended St. Petersburg College and received the degree in mechanical engineering back in 1973 as a young bootstrap officer from the Corps of Engineers that came back to get an engineering degree. So I have fond roots here at St. Petersburg College, and that's why I work when I retired from Veolia to come back home here and do some things with the college. And so I'm very pleased, and these scholarships are very much needed for our kids and folks. I call them kids because they're all younger than I am, but we've had some folks who are adults and returning to continuing their education. So these scholarships are critical. We have several corporate partners that have aligned themselves with us, and we are so pleased and proud of having these corporate partners, and we want to grow that list. And it's so important to us to continue to be out in the community. And as we did at the strategic planning session, we put together our one-minute elevator pitch to make sure that all of the board members understand their role, responsibility in going out to the community. And now we'll ask any questions that conclude our presentation.
Is the scholarship luncheon coming up?
Yes, March 31st. I hope you'll be there.
I think I did.
I think you are on the red.
I think I RSVP'd. I knew I'd vaguely seen it pass my peripheral vision there. The only thing I would suggest to the rest of the board, if you haven't had a chance to come to this scholarship luncheon, there is nothing, very, very few things that will motivate you more than hearing a few of the students get up and speak. And, you know, I swore that I wasn't coming back because you made me cry last time. But it's really a fabulous opportunity to hear just the challenges that some of our students get through to succeed.
We're having a big challenge trying to narrow it down to three speakers this year. Their stories are all just amazing, whether they've encountered a great deal of hardship or just they're the average student who's plugging along. It's right. Just wonderful. So thank you for your comments. And I did also, Bill referred to the fact that his tenure as chairman is coming to a close at the end of this month, and he will stay on the board. But I just wanted to comment on how much he has done for this organization. We were so very, very fortunate to have him and our past chairmans as well. But he has just been fabulous. So I thank him for that. Any other questions?
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Well done. Thank you.
Next item, strategic focus and planning under student success and achievement. Dr. Cooper, American Association of Community College Pathways.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman, members of the board, Dr. Law. I'm here to give you an update on the American Association of Community Colleges Pathways project. Some of you may recall, and for those who are new, this was a project that we applied for back in the fall term, and it is a nationwide project under the umbrella of the American Association of Community Colleges, also supported by other nationally recognized organizations like the Community College Research Center, Jobs for the Future, Achieving the Dream, the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, and others. After our application, we received notification in October that we were one of only 30 colleges throughout the nation that was selected to be a part of the project, and we are one of four colleges out of Florida that were also chosen, so we're very proud of that. What this will provide us with are opportunities to participate in what are called institutes, where we will engage with other nationally recognized institutions, share best practices, learn from others, share what we're doing to improve student success. We also feel it will give us the opportunity to accelerate the integration of various college-wide initiatives, such as the college experience, the classroom experience, and student engagement outside the classroom, and provide the means, most importantly, for increasing our student completion rates. There are four main goals associated with this project, and the first is to map pathways to a student's end goal. The pathway is more than just the list of courses or sequence of courses that a student would complete as part of a program. The pathway, and it's sometimes referred to as a guided pathway, starts when a student first makes contact with St. Petersburg College and continues on through to their finish, which may be to achieve their AA degree and transfer to another institution, or it may be to complete a terminal degree and get a job. So we want to make sure that throughout that process or pathway that all of our programs are well designed, that they're integrated so that there is a streamlined way of communicating with our students and we don't have various entities within the college providing the same communication, because then for many students it becomes like background noise. We want to unify that student experience across their time with us so that irregardless of what modality they may be learning in, whether that's online or on ground on our campuses, that they are provided with equity in regards to the services. We also want to make sure that guidance is provided to them, not only through information, but we also want to give them opportunities to experience what it's like to be part of a particular discipline or a particular area of employment. So we are suggesting a framework, and we're referring to them as career and academic communities. We also know that research shows that learning communities are very important to help students succeed when they can learn from one another, learn from their peers, partner with others in regards to studying and being successful in their courses. So if we look at our various programs today and our transfer plans, we feel that we can fit all of them into one of 10 career and academic communities, and we have those outlined there for you. The second goal in regards to this project is to, first of all, get students on a path. excuse me. So we want to identify their preliminary area of interest. And of course, we already provide students with the opportunity to complete a career interest inventory when they come to us. And we provide them with information about what programs are available to them. And so we feel that this would provide students with the opportunity to begin to make a choice. But we also want to make sure that they really understand what's involved before they get on a specific path. So if we look at their first 15 credit hours, all students that are in a particular career and academic community are probably taking very similar gen ed courses, communication, math, ethics, American national government. So could we bring them together in those communities, in those gen ed courses, have our gen ed faculty and our program faculty or discipline faculty come together and talk about, is there an opportunity to contextualize some of those gen ed courses? Doesn't mean that the learning outcomes would be different from those courses, but we might theme the course so that they're reading literature associated, for example, with the health field, if that's one of the areas that they want to go into. They're with students who are also interested in the health field. So it provides them with more opportunity to think through their decision before they get on a specific path, say for nursing or respiratory care or radiology if it's in the health field. We also feel that there's an opportunity to contextualize the Smart Start orientation. So as part of learning about the careers that they're interested in, say if they're in the health field community, then they can learn that it's not just nursing. There are multiple opportunities in the health fields that they might be interested in, and they can learn about what's necessary, what are the foundation skills, why is this math important, why is it important to be able to communicate. And so we feel that there's opportunity to give them that experience. They might shadow. They might have opportunities to meet with employers from the various fields. If they're a transfer student, they could be in contact with, we could provide opportunities for them to be in contact with the faculty at the transfer institution or upper division students. So they have a much better understanding. So it's providing those experiential learning opportunities early in the pathway so that they are making a better informed decision about their particular career. Next goal is we want to, of course, keep the students on their path. It's important that when we communicate with them along the path that we are reaching out to those students who are doing well and encouraging them so they continue to persevere. It's also important that we reach out to those who are falling off the path or having difficulty so that we can provide them with any necessary assistance, whether that's additional tutoring services. As we know, many of our students experience life issues, and so we want to be able to reach out to them and provide them with the necessary assistance so that they will continue and be successful. We also want to embed along the academic pathways, and we have a handout for you just to give you an example. This is our Computer and Networking Associate in Science degree, and what you'll see indicated on here are the number of courses that they can take and where then an industry certification, which has obviously a value in regards to employment, that they can sit for that exam, and we provide them with a test preparation as well as the vouchers to sit for the exam because some of them are expensive, and again, encouraging them to acquire those meaningful certifications along their pathway. One of the other things that we want to do is to look at our policies in regards to students completing their math and English requirements early in their time with us. Research shows that students who complete the college-level math and English early in their tenure with us, they are more likely to be successful and complete. One of the pieces of data associated with the American Association of Community Colleges Pathways project is to look at what they're calling key performance indicators. One of these indicators looks at the number of students who are completing their college-level math, at least one college-level math course and one college-level English course in their first year. And we see that here at St. Petersburg College, if we look back to fall 2012, and one other caveat or note that I need to make is these are for students who are first time ever in college. They have not done any dual enrollment. And we see that there is an increase, so we're headed in the right direction, but we feel we can do better, particularly in regards to completing the college level math and English within their first year. These are foundational skills to their being successful, and we don't want students to wind up in their final semester struggling with math. And so we're going to look at those policies. What happened, we had policies in place, but with the legislation on developmental ed, that changed, and so we need to revisit those and make sure that we are encouraging students to start their math pathway early in their tenure and to take it in a sequence so they don't stop out and then forget, because math is sequential, and then same with their communication skills. One of the other key performance indicators with this project looks at the number of students completing a certain number of college credit hours within their first year. And so, again, we see that we're moving in the right direction, but we feel we can do better. We know many of our students come to us part-time, and if we can move them from the 15 credit hour completion in their first year to 24, they're much more likely to complete, because it's a shorter time frame for them to complete their degree. They could do it then in 2.5 years or 3 at the most. Finally, we want to ensure that students are learning along their pathway. This is important in regards to how we map the program learning outcomes to the various courses along the pathway. And it's important for faculty to understand, based on where their particular course is in the sequence, is this where the learning outcome is just introduced? Is this where it's going to be practiced and reinforced? Or is this where it should be now mastered and synthesized with all the other things that they have learned? And so obviously then, we want our faculty to come together. We want our gen ed faculty talking with our program faculty so that we are making sure that that sequence is being addressed appropriately, not only within the classroom environment, but also in regards to their assessment protocols. So some of the next steps that are coming up, we have another institute taking place in April in Washington, D.C., and the team will be going to participate in that. We also want to establish a college-wide oversight committee for the guided pathways. Two important aspects here is to make sure that the communication throughout the milestones in a student's experience with us, 15 credit hours, 30 credit hours, 45, and 60, that is consistent and streamlined and makes sense. We also want to make sure that the classroom experience components are being addressed, and are there areas in which we can make sure that that's integrated with the college experience and student engagement outside the classroom. So we'll be doing a summer institute. We've done these for the last 3 or 4 years now. We've found them very beneficial in going back and having the programs look at their curriculum and making sure that we're mapping the certifications and certificates and degree programs. We also want to make sure that we're mapping all of our transfer plans so students know from beginning to end they have a clear pathway and that there are opportunities for internships along that, industry certifications, etc. And then we'll also be identifying within that first 15 credit hours the common career and academic community initial coursework. Any questions? Sure.
Dr. Cooper, on the handout that we got, the sample plan that's on the reverse.
Yes.
A part-time student with a 4-year plan. Is this Is this curriculum possible in a for a full-time student over 2 years?
Yes.
So either way, it works either way.
Right. And if the student follows just the sequence of courses on the pathway itself, then they can obviously complete more courses per semester. Any other questions?
Here are the parts that will be snuggest. I think as we move forward, guiding choices for students in general education courses, we have literally thousands, more than 1,000 options in all of the gen ed courses, more than any student could possibly wade through and choose. And we've asked the deans to say, what's the best gen ed course for this student in this sequence of courses? It makes a difference if you're what you're in. That one, we've already started, we're over that one. And mentioned documenting the learning, the assessment piece. That's going to get very snug with faculty because we expect the assessments to be common across everybody teaching the same courses. The faculty have to decide what those assessments look like. We have to be sure that we can describe what those assessments look like to the students and to the employers in our area. Those are very serious questions. That's what the essence of a good college education is all about. So we're kind of back at the root issues. I think we're in good shape. Let me break. We have 183 of these. We have one for every program the college offers. And yesterday I was asking, we have a growing number of the certificates within each of the programs. We're bringing those to the forefront in all of what we do. So all of that work is, you know, it sounds so easy to describe after the fact. It's really very hard day-to-day work, and Ann has done a great job leading that. We're in for a long ride on this one. It's going to take us 2 or 3 years to get this exactly the way we want it. I think we're off to a great start.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Next item on student services, tobacco-free campus, Ms. Connor and Mr. Chan.
Good morning, Mr. Chair, members of the board, Dr. Law. My name is Jamel Connor, and I'm the provost of the St. Petersburg Gibbs campus, and I'm here with Patrick Chan, who's a student also on the St. Petersburg Gibbs campus. Today, we're bringing forward to you a proposal for your consideration and approval to make St. Petersburg campus, all of our sites and campuses, tobacco-free as of August 1st, 2016.
Good morning, Mr. Chair, members of the board, and Dr. Law. I appreciate you for having me here today to speak on an issue that has arisen from the students, which is tobacco use at SPC. So first, let me give you an overview on how we started. So the issue was brought up back in September at our semi-annual Lunch with the Provost event when a student complained about having to walk through tobacco smoke every day on her way to class. This followed in a round of applause by the rest of the students in attendance. From there, I took on the role of chairing the Tobacco-Free Committee. So our 5 goals that the Tobacco-Free Task Force abided by from the beginning were to, 1, protect non-smokers here at SPC from secondhand smoke. 2, encourage and make it easier for tobacco users to quit. 3, promote a collegiate culture of wellness. 4, denormalize tobacco use and prevent initiation. And 5, create a policy that works for everyone college-wide to be determined by the majority of the SPC community. After many months of extensive research, data collection, and events held, here are the results of a survey that was sent online to students college-wide of over 1,500 responses. 62% said they are in favor of having a tobacco-free or smoke-free college. Along with this and other statistics and comments from the survey, the task force concluded that a tobacco-free policy would be the best route to take. This initiative and the committee were approved by the Student Government Association College-wide, Council of Campus Provosts, and Executive Leadership Committee. So the task force then proceeded to draft a mock tobacco-free policy, which was signed unanimously by the student government presidents at all 8 campuses. This policy would prohibit students, faculty, staff, contractors, college partners, and visitors from using smoked tobacco, smokeless tobacco, and electronic cigarettes on all campuses. This policy would also provide free cessation programs available to all students, faculty, and staff. In fact, We already have over 100 student smokers who are signed up to attend free cessation programs if offered here at SPC. Now, if SPC were to go tobacco-free today, we would join more than 1,100 colleges and universities nationwide in an effort to promote a clean and healthy learning environment. I'd like to take this time to thank Provost Connor, Associate Provost Baptiste, and Provost Carver, as they have been instrumental in helping facilitate this issue throughout the year. I'll now pass on to Provost Connor. Thank you.
So if approved, the timeline for implementation would be for the rest of the spring term and the summer term, we would educate, prepare, and support. So that would include a multifaceted communication plan to all of our current students, faculty, staff, and partners, as well as our future students that would be looking forward to coming to us next year. We'll also be developing our official college policies and procedures surrounding a tobacco-free campus, and then we'll be working on facility changes. We need to change our signage, remove the designated smoking areas, get all of that ready to go, and then, as Patrick mentioned, working with our students, faculty, and staff in starting programs for cessation resources, having those available for everyone. And then we would look to implement in fall 2016, specifically August 1st, 2016, on all college campuses and sites. Are there any questions?
So I do have a question, but I'll say, nice job presenting, Mr. Chan.
Thank you.
Well done.
Very nice.
Appreciate it.
And I'm in favor of this type of thing, but I have from a legal standpoint, Mr. Lang, Ms. Gardner, are there any issues with enforcing this type of policy at an entity like St. Pete College?
Well,
the college currently has a policy that mirrors the Florida Clean Indoor Air Act, which is basically indoor smoking, and then we designate outside. The statutes, the Florida statutes, do authorize a board of trustees of a Florida college system institution to regulate the use of tobacco, so we do have the authority to do it.
And some schools that already have a tobacco-free policy are HCC, USF, UF, and Ecker College.
Mr. Chair, I move that we accept the tobacco-free policy on our campuses.
Do I have a second?
Second. Well done.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed? So moved.
Mr. Chairman, I see some other students in the background. Did you bring a cheering section, Patrick? Let's have them stand up if you would.
They've also been a vital part of this initiative. They're from student government at the Gibbs campus.
Okay.
This is Ileana and Sydney.
Ladies, please introduce yourself.
Absolutely. I'm Ileana Yanez, treasurer of the SGA at Gibbs campus, and I'm very happy to be here with you this morning.
And I'm Sydney Caraggio, secretary at Gibbs campus.
Very good.
Nice. Thank you.
Thanks very much. Thanks for the great work, Patrick. Okay. Thank you. Nicely.
It was all them, too.
Jesse, is there any relate? Jesse, is there any relation?
Yes,
that's
my daughter.
Well done. Very good. Next on the budget and finance, monthly financial report, Ms. Hunt.
Yes. Good morning, Mr. Chair, board members, and Dr. Law. This morning I'm going to present on the monthly report and then also give you an update on the fiscal year 16-17 budget. So the first slide on our revenue, our tuition is at 84%. It's still trending the same as the last few months. And then two items I want to note on this revenue. One is the state appropriation lottery, where we received our first allocation of $2.9 million in February, and we will be receiving another $11 million in the next few months. Then in our funds transfer in, we've received our first allocation or transfer in of $574,000, and we'll be receiving that money. If you remember in the last month presentation, we went over our Fund 3, which was our auxiliary fund, and some of that fund supports our operating fund, and this is the transfer. Overall, our revenue is at 66%. Our expense, we're trending the same, which is about 2% less than what we've our budget target is, which is at 63%. Overall, our fund balance is at $3.5 million closing out that month. So now I want to give you an update on our budget development. On March 3rd, we had our strategic budget presentation day where our college staff comes together and they present their strategic requests for budget based on the initiatives that were discussed in our December board workshop. There were 28 presenters. They presented 66 requests, and the total of the requests were $2.3 million. Here's a summary of some of our requests by the initiative. The top four I'll mention, the College Experience Student Success Initiative was $721,000 in requests. Our Academic and Instructional Enhancements at $567,000 total requests. Engagement Beyond the Classroom at $402,000. Our Strategic Enrollment Plan at $330,000. And this here are a few other initiatives with some strategic requests dollars amounts attached. So our next step is from now through April 1st, we'll be prioritizing those requests. We have three committees, which are our academic issues, our student support, and system support committees. They will prioritize those requests, and then they'll go on to the Strategic Issues Council, which will do an overall prioritization. And then we'll make our recommendations based on our revenue projections. I'll hand over to Doug.
Good morning. Just so you know, your microphones are working. We're picking them up on the recording of the meeting, but apparently we have blown a fuse in the back on the speaker, so they're working on it. So I'll speak loudly. Now that the legislative session is done, I wanted to take a few minutes to just give you a view of where we came out and where we think we will be starting July 1st of 2016. So what I'll do is start with where this year's budget began and then quickly run through what has transpired, and this may help some of our new board members kind of see the path we've been on this year. July 1st we started, our revenue budget was $156 million, and with the once we started realizing the downturn in enrollment during the fall session, we actually reduced our tuition projection by about 26,000 student semester hours, which was a little over $2 million. So I think got us through the year. The legislative session, when it ended, increased our college program fund, what we call the CCPF, the Community College Program Fund, reduced it by $2.9 million. Right now, that consists of $1.8 million reduction because they held back $30 million from all the colleges for performance funding. So they took $1.8 million out, transferred $1.8 million to lottery, and then we had a couple of other miscellaneous items that were smaller amounts, but those were the two largest reductions as they sit right now. What we have done in the what I'm going to show you in a minute in the summary, we went ahead and added the base performance funds back in, or that we just did that ourselves. We haven't received it, but for projection. And then there is an additional $1.8 million that is possible, depending where we end up falling out when they run the final performance funding numbers. So we, with that said, our overall revenue, we anticipate being about $152.5 million, so a little less than $4 million lower than when we started July 1. Dr. Law?
Doug, let's take just a second, though, to just make sure everybody's following on the performance funding. The legislature and the governor put $30 million new dollars on the table for colleges to earn based on performance. The colleges have to put $30 million from their own existing funds on the table for a $60 million pot. Our share of the $30 million on the table is $1.8 million. So under, in theory, and in fact, in reality, you have 1.8 million at risk. If you cross the divide and you're okay, you get another, you get your money back and you get one,
and 1.
That
8.
Much again. There's some other upside kinds of things. I was going to share this later, but now's an important time. We don't know where that is. It's on the chancellor's desk. They've added some additional criteria, which is, I think, good for us. Last year, we were pretty nervous. They'd really not done us any favors with the criteria as we ended up. We haven't seen where the lists are in who's getting what in the performance funding. So that's coming at the next state board meeting. They added some criteria, and of course, then they have weights on the criteria, and we've argued that some of the ones that are important to us should be weighted at the top of the line. Simply trying to make a budget, though, we put our 1.8 back in. That's, we'd be disappointed right. if we don't get that. And then there's going to be an additional 1.8 we think that will follow based on. So Doug, now go ahead and show the spreadsheet kind
Mr. President, I have a quick yes. question of you. So I can read it in the state budget and I understand it. So we have put our money into a pot of $60 million, and we have the capability of getting more than 1.8 million back based upon the numbers that we show, and then the chancellor makes that decision July 1.
Oh, I expect it'll happen in the next month or so.
Okay.
Deborah, Mr. Gibbons. I simply don't know exactly when they will take this to the state. It requires, because there are some who will fall below the standards
sure.
line, you have to file a report. You can get your money back if the report is acceptable, whatnot. But they have to have, the state board has to approve the process.
Well, I just asked that question because yep. I want the general right. public to be understand that we are not in jeopardy of
losing
$1.8 million
yeah.
that we put into a pot. We're actually in a better position.
I hope we're in a better position. I don't know that for a fact, though, Mr. Gibbons, yep. okay? So, yeah, okay. We're all set. I just want to, we're trying to figure out how to show you a budget that makes some sense. So we've put some monies on all the lines. Doug, if
right.
you'll show us, okay?
Yeah, let me quickly run through the expense side. Again, we started July 2015 with $120 million in personnel expense budgeted. Again, with the downturn in the fall, then we looked at the expense side to hold our spending, and we held $1.2 million of faculty positions. We reduced the adjunct supplemental, this is instructional expense, by another million. This was in the fall. And we held some other administrative vacancies. We also, every year at this time, we go through and we recalculate where we are on all of our salaries and benefit costs, because we always have turnover and rehiring rates. And we saved about $800,000 that freed up revenue on the personnel line. Now, we did have a few items. We had our career advising model that you may recall from that are in the budget this year but had not been funded for next year. Women on the Way, and then the Bay Pines personnel, and that's approximately $419,000. Which we needed to fund, so we went ahead and put that in to start the year. So we anticipate our personnel cost to be about $117.4 million when we present the final budget. On the current expense and capital budget, not as big of a variation there, but we started about $35.4 million. We just, in the fall, again, we had a college-wide, we all the vice presidents got together, we looked at all of our expenses, and we came up with a total of $1.2 million that we cut in the fall to reduce our spending in line with the revenue cuts. Again, we had a couple of items. We had the call center we contracted out that we needed to include in the budget the second year of that. We also had some technology software, about $200,000. And then we went in and just did some minor capital reductions by about $50,000. So we anticipate about $35 million in our expense and capital to start the 16-17 year. So let me quickly just show you then what that looks like when you look at the detailed numbers. This reflects the our tuition estimate. We reconfigured our schedule and we now estimate our tuition revenue to be about $56.5 million. Our state appropriations about 51.9. That's again with the performance taken out. The most significant item was when I said they transferred 1.8 of our general operating to lottery. It will go from about 14.9 to about 16.7 million. That's significant to us and many of the other colleges simply because they've been doing that now for 3 or 4 years in a row. And we don't get that lottery money till about the last 3 months of the year, as Jeanette showed you. Whereas our CCPF, we get a equivalent portion every month. So it does sometimes can have cash flow. We don't anticipate any right now, but I would hate to see that grow too big. This, I'm showing you the line now where I've added half of the performance funding back in, the $1.8 million, and then just the rest of the fee adjustments that will put us at about the 152.4 mark. This is the detailed numbers on the expense side, and as you can see, it's basically flat, a little about $50,000. So assuming the 1.8 and nothing else is vetoed, that is where we should land at a minimum. What to me is significant, maybe most about this, is that last year we gave that pay raise, the 3% pay raise, and of course that was predicated on at least flat enrollment and so on. So with the downturn, I think we're in pretty good shape, considering that the 3% expenses, all personnel expenses included in this. So we will have funded the increase as well as some of the other things that we needed to fund going forward, and at least right now, at worst case, we're flat. So that said.
Mr. Chairman, members of the board, so it's just March. We still have several months to adopt a budget. We're working on what the individual projects that reflect your earlier priorities for us, the January priority listing. We'll just manage them back and forth and give you monthly updates as we say we believe this one executes that priority. There's no more money. There's some more money. However that works. So we'll continue to work with you. Doug and Jeanette have done a good job trying to get us squared away as to what our ongoing commitments look like this year. So you have our up-to-date picture. I don't know what else. If you have other questions, we have good vice presidents who can answer.
Any questions?
Thank you.
All right.
Thank you.
Next, budgeted enrollment plan for 2016-2017. Dr.
Crodwell. Good morning. Mr. Chair, members of the board, Dr. Law. That was my daughter, Sydney. Her and Ileana actually are both, in addition to be participating in student government on St. Pete Gibbs campus, they're both in the Collegiate High School as well. And Sydney will both be graduating this year. Sydney will be attending University of Florida this next fall.
Go Gators.
Yeah, well, I'm still getting used to that part of it, but certainly an excellent university.
You're getting smarter.
So I wanted to share a little bit about the budget enrollment plan. I know we met last month and talked a little bit about some of the detail on how we build a budget. I'm going to reflect a little bit on that presentation as we start out, and then I'm going to dive into a lot of data associated with the plan, look at some trend information, and then ultimately what we're going to be doing this next year beginning in July. So just a reminder from the prior presentation, when we build a schedule, there's two really guiding values that we look to. That is that we design an academic course schedule that meets student needs, and you'll see that reflected in terms of our capacity throughout our process. And the second is we don't cancel courses. Because it is a guaranteed schedule, at that point the students can see the schedule and see the courses, they won't be canceled for any reason at that point forward. Now, as a management process, we tend to keep a little bit back in reserve and release those adjusted based on demand, because we don't always know exactly what students are. So there's typically about 8% that we'll hold back as we go forward. This I also showed last month, but this is just a quick reflection of some of the trend data. I'm going to dive into the next slide, and we're going to actually look at some very detailed headcount information and student semester hour information, so we can look at some of the trends. So the first one we're going to look at, data going back to 2010 through an estimate for 2015. So 2015-16 we're in right now. We've had fall. We have pretty much all we're going to have for spring. What we don't have yet is summer data. So what I've done for the estimation is assuming that we're going to be flat this summer and then did the annual calculations. So what you can see as we move from 10-11, this is impacted by the economy. So if we go back a little bit further past 2010, you actually see a growth spurt that we were in as a college. But around this time, the economy started to improve, and we see some of the reversed
cyclical relationship that we have with the economic indicators. In 2011, we dropped about 1.9%. You can see the headcount information and the student semester hour information for that entire annual time period. Down about 4.3% in 2012. 2013, we're down 2.6%. We saw a slight uptick in terms of enrollment in 2014. We were actually up just about 1% for the year. And we're anticipating about a 2.6% decrease as we get into 2015. I want to dive in a little further and look at some information associated with specific terms. So we're going to look as fall 2014 to present. And when we see, when we look at this information, we've added another value, another measure, and that's percent full. So what this is looking at is the number of slots. We hesitate to use the term seats because it really doesn't imply in a virtual environment. But in essence, you know, kind of think about it in terms of capacity. How many student slots do we have to each of our courses? And in our system, we've actually designed them so we have the appropriate number of seats associated to the appropriate course. So we're looking at things on papers in the course. We're looking at things on, in certain aspects, accreditation, safety, things that might go into play. So that's all been pre-established in the model. So we look at fall, we look at student semester hours, you see about 272,000. Our increase year over year from the previous fall, we were up actually up 1.1%. If you remember when we looked at the prior year, we were actually up 0.9 for the entire year. And our fill ratio was 88.6%. So that's how full we were. Our target as we go forward is 90%. When we get into spring data, you can see we're still up about 1%, but not as efficient when we look at how full we were. We were at 85.7%. And then when we go to summer, we'll see summer was flat, which is good in terms of enrollment and revenue, but wasn't as good when we talked about planning, because we were actually expecting growth in summer. Based on the information that we had in the prior terms, we were expecting growth, and the growth didn't occur. And what happens is you'll see a fill ratio then is 72.6%. So, you know, kind of taking a business example, we had too much inventory during the summer. And though we were flat in terms of growth, we were only down 0.3%, there was too much inventory available. We look at fall, we were down 3.2%. We were at 85.6 in terms of fill ratio, again, over planning. We've done a little better in the spring, and this is probably the best term that we've had for the 3 years that we're working on this guaranteed academic schedule process. So we came very close to our 90% at 89.9%. We did have a decrease in enrollment. But we met our cost estimates by basically the amount of inventory that we had present. And I realize I'm going through a lot of detailed information, so please feel free if you have questions as we go along to ask. I'm going to dive out a little bit further and unpack the data in terms of modality. So what we're going to separate here is on ground, I'm going to refer to face-to-face enrollment, and we're going to look at online enrollment. And you're going to see some very different patterns when we look at things such as growth and things such as how full we are in terms of our sections. So we look at fall 2014. I'm going to stay at the top just for a minute. You see our student semester hours. You see our change year over year. We're down about 1.1% and are 85% full. Spring, pretty flat at 0.5 down, 82%. Summer, which we talked before about the overplanning, we were actually only 63.6%. So we were only two-thirds full on the campuses last summer, even though we were pretty much flat in terms of enrollment at 0.2% up. We look at this past fall, we were down 4.2%, and for this past spring, we were down 4.4%. And you see the appropriate fill ratios down in the low 80s, 82 and 83, 86%. Very different picture when we begin to look at the perspective in terms of online enrollment. For online, you're going to see much higher fill ratios. Now, keep in mind, when we're planning for online enrollment, we don't have the same type of constraints. We're not worried about time of day. We're not worried about day of week. We can just enroll students in classes. There also, it seems to be, based on the data, we're showing more demand for students to take classes in an online environment. Student semester hours, 103,000 for fall 2014. We were up almost 5% in terms of year over year, and you see our fill ratio is 94.7%. When we look at spring, we were up 3.2%, again 92. Summer, you know, a little bit different student group, down a little bit, about 0.8%, but still 82% full as comparison to about 63 we had for face-to-face classes. In fall, we were down 1.6%. Fill ratio is 91.8. And then this spring, again, I think it's one of the best we've planned, 100% full in terms of our online. In fact, over 100%, because there is some capacity that we can add students easier in an online environment than we can in a face-to-face environment, and up about 1.3% in terms of enrollment. So using this data, we put together our planned schedule. Again, as I mentioned before, we're building a schedule to meet student needs. So I'm going to call out the capacity factors as we look through the information. But you have the prior term. This is fall we're going to look at first. We'll go through each of the terms. Prior term information as comparison to the current SSH capacity. We have our budgeted information. That's what we expect to be, what percentage we expect to be full. Our percent full estimations, and then our percent change. So we're planning on the very high level of being flat, having the same enrollment that we had the previous year. We are making some adjustments associated with modality. So we're planning a 1% growth in terms of online, which results in a decrease in face-to-face, and here for fall, we're gonna see it's 0.6%. Any questions on that one before I go on to the next couple terms?
So we have 103,000 students.
This is student semester hours. So if I'm an individual student, I took a 3-credit-hour class, that'd be counted as three.
I was like, I don't know, 103,000 students online.
30,000 enrollments, though.
30,000 enrollments.
Yeah. Yeah, we'd have to be Miami-Dade to get into the the 100,000 range.
I was just about to ask you, do we pass them? Because
yeah.
I don't have my glasses, so I can't see that SSH.
There you
go. So this, we use SSH because it connects to dollars when we talk about revenue estimates, because students are going to pay per the credit hour. So, you know, if it's a 1-credit-hour class, 2 or 3, that's going to be a way to manage that perspective. When we look in spring enrollment, again, the factors that we've locked is the highest level, expecting flat enrollment, and then using adjustment in the increase for online of a 1% growth for online. In the case of spring, based on the student distribution, it's 0.7% down in our face-to-face enrollment. These are appropriate for our targets in terms of how full we intend to be on those classes. And then finally, for our summer, same flat across the top, but a 1% growth. In summer, this results in a 1.2% decline in our face-to-face enrollment. So in summary, our schedule reflects flat enrollment projections based on the prior year enrollment. We're expecting that minor shift from face-to-face and online enrollment, growing that 1%. And as you can see from the factors we've shown, there's sufficient capacity for student registration. Any questions?
I have one question.
Sure.
Where do we think this levels out? I know we're showing flat projecting into next year as far as student semester hours. Where was it back in 2006, 2007? Was it very similar to where it is now?
No, it was actually growing.
Okay.
I mean, we were growing at one point as a college double digits. In fact, the biggest fear, when you look at the economic impact factors, you show that reverse cyclical relationship. There's other outstanding factors, but that seems to have the highest correlation to changes. But we were in a great growth mode. I mean, when the economy was declining, we were growing, you know, double-digit increases. In fact, one of our fears was, you know, because it was so reverse cyclical, is the fear is that you don't want to be declining in double digits either.
But before the decline, were the student semester hours similar to what they are now?
No, we're still considerably up because we haven't dropped as quick as we increased. I mean, at one point, we were at near capacity in terms of our on-ground. I mean, we were looking for closets and stuff to hold classrooms. I mean, it got that much in growth. We've dropped off, but nowhere near as much as we've increased.
Okay. Just to help you a little bit, too, Mr. Stone-Seifert, prior to Dr. Law, we were growing probably at an average pace, but when the economy went to the tank, we grew in double digits just about every year. Our objective was, when Dr. Law came in, is not just because we're growing that fast, we didn't want folks. And usually what happens, as you probably well know, is when the economy's in the tank, people are losing their jobs, number one. Number two, they're trying to retool themselves to get a better job so they can move up in the workforce. And then, but we didn't want to have, this is Mr. Caraggio said, where when the economy came back, people said, okay, well, I don't have to go to school anymore. We tanked in the double digits too, and we didn't do that. So I think we're pretty on pace with what we thought was going to happen as a result of recruiting and marketing and some other stuff, right, Dr. Law, to keep people in school and getting educated.
We ask ourselves the same question. You know, when we get there, will we know we're there? What's really going to happen? We're working as hard as we can now to keep everybody who is enrolled to come back. And we're getting pretty granular on that, but we're still not the breakthrough stage on that. The attraction of new, we had 5,800 new students last year in the fall semester. So students are still coming to us. We're just not a big growth area of the state either. So we're managing it at a pretty fine level here. When you see us talk about, adding, 1% and 2%, it's an art. It's not really a science. We can't turn a knob and make it happen. So.
And retention, I mean, our focus at the end of the day is growth. I mean, that's what we're looking for. We haven't hit it. We want to be fiscally responsible in those designs. But really, the low-hanging fruit is retention. I mean, the students are already here. And that's where we're putting so much of our effort in that respect, because it's a lot easier to keep them than it is to get them brand new.
Mr. Chair, I do have one quick question. Dr. Law, as I see it, we're starting to grow to be one of the largest online providers. My company actually was looking for a provider, and we ended up finding that St. Pete College is probably the largest provider in the state right now of online courses. What does our pass-fail rate look like, and how are we monitoring the growth? I know we have somebody on new. Do we have a scheduled growth in terms of the courses, or?
Yeah, well, thanks. Great question. And that's what we're trying to do, is to move to follow the student demand. Going to tell you more than you want to know. What happens is if the only way a student can get in a course at the end is to take an online course, then it grows unnaturally. Those are not the students we want in online. They waited till the last minute. Now they show up. That's the only seat left. So we're working to plan which enrollment we want to do. Ann and the deans have purposefully now moved to expand the online on day one, so students can get into those if that's what they want. We see the night enrollment going down on campuses because those are the folks who were taking the online course. If you're a single mom or somebody who's at work, you may say it's a better deal just to take the online course rather than drive to one of the campuses. So the shifts are sort of subtle. I think there's still more growth online. I think there's still more growth online for us to do that. We have been focused very strongly on the success rates. When we did the realignment of distance learning, the consultant we had said, Dr. Law, you keep talking about that being a problem. Your overall success rates in online look just like your face-to-face. And I said, disaggregated. We have programs where the success rate is exceptionally high. Nursing, vet tech, people who are career-oriented, they're working for a credential, they know exactly what they're doing. Those are in the 90-95% success rate online. Developmental education is 38%. That's not acceptable. We know that. So we now have a full range of student services that are available online we have I'm trying to think, 40% of our students take at least one online course every semester. So there's a bunch of students taking online courses. Making progress on that, Mr. Gibbons. Not quite exactly where we want it to be, but we have, that's our number one focus now, is making sure students are supported online. They're not just placed in those courses as a convenience on the last day of registration. Yeah, we probably have beaten this to death, but the most important thing to me is to understand what do students need on the first day of classes. The dean's job is to make sure there is a seat for a student on the first day of courses. About 60% of that enrollment is taught by full-time faculty in one mode or another. 30 or 40% is taught by adjuncts. We put a great deal of training into adjuncts. So it's not like anyone's going to, we're not on the bubble for somebody losing their job or not losing their job, those sorts of things. We're trying to make sure no faculty members are doing too much teaching just to earn the money. Some will teach 7 or 8 sections in a semester. You got to be a pretty good instructor to handle 8 different sections. We would prefer that, you know, 5 or 6 is a very common workload. There's only one set of numbers, though, to drive the budget. You have just seen them. There is the guaranteed annual schedule, whatever that number is for the year, 614,000. That's the number that we drive through for student activity and service fee. That's the number we drive through for enrollment. That's the number we drive through for what books to buy in the bookstore. Everybody's on the same page, doesn't get discounted on this campus or at this level. Everybody has one number. You have that number today, and you see then how it feeds right into the budget. We just crosswalk it to whatever the tuition is.
All right, thank you.
Thanks.
Next up, administrative matters, update on the Clearwater Library, Mr. Wechter and Dr. Goodacre.
And they have some visitors. I'll ask them to introduce. Well, we have the people from the Clearwater side of the Clearwater Library.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman, members of the board, Dr. Law. I'm Jim Wechter with your facilities department, and with me today are Dr. Stan Vitito, provost of the Clearwater campus, Ms. Barbara Pickell, director of libraries for the city of Clearwater, and Ms. Jill Silverboard, assistant city manager for the city of Clearwater. Also here are our construction and design partners, Leo Arroyo, principal architect from Canada Belskin Arroyo, and Josh Baumstein, president of Creative Contractors. Our purpose today is just to give you a brief update on the progress of the project. We're very encouraged of where we are today, and I'll let Stan walk us through the presentation. I think you'll appreciate the fact that we have, what you'll see is fundamentally the same as the schematic design you saw last fall, but with a much greater level of specificity. So I'll turn it over to Stan.
Thank you, Jim, and thank you for the opportunity to present you with a little bit of an update on this project. You can see from the first slide there the existing library and existing administration building. And just to let you orient yourself, the top of the slide is north, and you see Drew Street running across the top and Old Coachman Road running along the right-hand side. The new library will be built in front of the existing library site, and the administration building, as you can see, will be removed. We're able to do that because the existing administration building has a number of functions that, well, it was designed for functions that we do differently now. For example, we had a very large business office when that building was built in 1965, and students were coming in to pick up paper checks and coming in to pay their bills. The majority of our students now, of course, pay their bills online, and all of the refund checks are received electronically. In addition to that, the older style of advising and counseling was that we had a whole row of offices, and students would come make appointments or stop in to see people. All that has been exchanged for a more open concept, and so we're able to move some of those administrative functions. Part of those, including the Career Center, will go into the new library. Others will be moved to other places on the campus. You can see the former administration site is now a parking lot. 80 of those newer parking places will go to the city for their use as part of the library for city patrons. The net change in parking in terms of students will be about a loss of 6 parking places, and that's 6 parking places out of 1,700 on the campus, so it's really negligible. You'll see the water feature in front. That's a nice enhancement for the campus. We'll move on to the first floor. The first floor is the joint use library with the city library occupying the top half of the building that you see there, and the Clearwater SPC is in the lower half. The center part of that is a computer lab and checkout center that's shared by both. I won't go into the details of the city library, but to the right-hand side is library processing and children's books. The sort of semi-circular seating area that you see in the middle is the children's story time area. On the Clearwater SPC side, to the left, you'll see some larger rooms that are used for quiet study, including a legal library, a number of smaller group study rooms along the bottom part of that diagram. When we studied libraries across the country, we visited libraries in California, the Jim Hunt Library in North Carolina, and a number of others. One of the things that we found was that students really want places that they can study in small groups. The collaborative nature of work today really demands that. So we've included a number of those along with quiet study for individual students. There's also a community room in the lower right-hand corner, and that's you'll see when you look at the elevations, it's really a nice kind of cube, actually. It's a two-story room. We have many, many outside groups that meet on the campus, everyone from Rotary East to Mothers Against Drunk Driving, and we anticipate with the joint use library that we'll have more, which is, you know, we are a community college after all, and we like being having the community on campus and being a part of that community. The second floor is all SPC. It's our tutoring. As you've probably heard in presentations here before, students who attend tutoring are much more successful than students who don't. This is an expanded tutoring session and a consolidation of all the tutoring activities on the campus into one place. So we currently have just a writing studio in the library, but now writing, science, math, computer technology, all the tutoring on the campus will be in one place. In addition, there's a career center, which is the first thing that you encounter when you come up the stairs. There's a classroom for teaching library information. And again, as you see, a number of individual study areas that can be used for group work, or we hope companies will take advantage of that to come up there and conduct interviews with students for jobs. Now we get to some of the most interesting parts of this. This is the view of the library as we would see it from Drew Street with the water feature, and you can see there's a lot of glass in there. One of our goals in building this was to design a very open facility, and even if you look at the floor plans, there are very few rooms divided off. We intend to identify the various functions that occur in those rooms through the use of, you know, lowered ceilings, movable whiteboards, movable technology panels, and so on. Here you can see the view of the library from the east side. This would be from the old coachman side. It would be the primary entrance for the city library. You can also see there's a drive-through. The city has requested a drive-through so that patrons can order their books in advance, if you will, and drive through and pick them up, and also drive through and drop them off. And finally, this is the elevation from the quad. You begin to see the open nature there. I think it's really a gorgeous view. We've tried to incorporate just a little bit of the accent of the limestone that's feature of the rest of the campus. You can see it there under the little canopy. One of the problems with the limestone is that it molds very badly and you just really can't hardly keep it clean. And so we've just incorporated under the canopy there where it'll stay nice and dry. You can see the two-story community room there to the right, that kind of cubicle. And then I think, Jim, you ready to present the timeline.
Yes, sir. Thank you, Stan. So what you see now are the significant dates moving forward, and I'm excited with the fact that we are now looking at dates rather than seasons, which is what you saw last time we talked about this. We have returned the 75% construction drawings to Leo and Josh, and they are working on developing those now into 100% drawings, which will be due to us in early May, the guaranteed maximum price in late May, to the City Council for their approval, the guaranteed maximum price, the operations agreement, the construction agreement, and the 100% documents, all to City of Clearwater City Council on June 16th, back to this board for final approval on the 21st, and we hope to have some shovels in the ground this summer. I'll leave it, ask Jill to make some closing comments.
Thanks. Thank you for the opportunity to speak briefly this morning on behalf of Mayor Credicus and our City Council, as well as our City Manager, Mr. Horn, who would have liked to have been here this morning. We just want to express our continued excitement about this project and our partnership. We believe that we can improve upon some of your earlier projects in communities such as Seminole and St. Petersburg, which have proven to be very successful in the minds of those communities. I used to live in Seminole and was a common user of that facility. So we are excited about this and our ability to deliver this joint use library to the Clearwater community and quite frankly to the entire library community, because as you know, our library serves as a member for the Pinellas Public Library Cooperative. And as a member in the cooperative, we are sharing materials across the entire Pinellas County user community. So it's a wonderful opportunity. One date that's not reflected in the slide that I would share with you is we are going to provide the City Council with this briefing next month so that they get the same early look in advance of seeing those agreements in June. So we're excited about finalizing the construction documents and moving to get those shovels in the ground. So thank you very much for having us this morning.
Thank you. Thank you.
Questions?
Thank you for my water feature.
I'm sorry?
Thank you for my water feature.
You got it. Thank you.
Very quickly, Mr. Chair, I got a couple quick comments and questions. I heard Dr. Vitito say clearly the four-star library and the St. P. College is one library. Everybody's going to be able to utilize it all together. So it is a joint use project, and I'm proud to say that I was a part of the very first one of these that happened on St. Pete campus, and it works very well. Everybody will be able to use any portion of the library. So there's no Clearwater side and there's no SPC side of the library.
And there's been a huge emphasis on that very issue in the design phase.
Dr. Vitito, I missed that portion of your comments. Where is the people that are in the existing administration building, where are they going to be moved to?
Learning Support Commons, and you're probably familiar enough with the Clearwater campus to know we've got that in the Language Arts building.
Yep.
And there's a huge open room there with very, very high ceilings right now where it's located.
Okay.
And so the registration, advising, business office, financial aid, those functions will move into that area.
Okay, cool. And then now I just want to make sure we don't have a parking problem as it exists. So we're taking away six spaces. I don't want somebody to say, oh, I don't have a parking space.
It's really seven. We're going to designate one with your name on it.
So
you can have a spot anytime you're there, okay?
And then,
I don't do parking.
We've got grass parking, though. We've got plenty of parking.
We've got plenty of parking. All right, good. I'm glad to hear you say that, Ms. Weston. And finally, the budget looks great. And this is going to be a great project. I'm looking forward to seeing the final product. I'm glad we're working with the City of Clearwater. We've been trying to do this for years, not the City of Clearwater stopped. It's just we had to acquire the land and do all this other stuff on your campus and get rid of some modular units and all that kind of stuff. But this is coming together and this is great. I'm ecstatic. I can't wait to see the finished product. But and I'm glad to see that we'll have a full learning lab as we do on most other campuses. I can tell you is the number one thing that we do for these students is giving them the help and expertise that they need to move forward in their classwork. And that learning lab looks like it's going to be a great one. So thank you for all you've done in this effort. Mr. Wechter, Dr. Vitito, and City of Clearwater should be committed. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Can I ask, when we move our business and advising center to that other building, are we going to style it as we did our Tarpon campus, so that it's going to have that openness and that open feel?
Yeah, we will. In fact, we're kind of working on the design of it already and shamelessly copying what they did up there. So
why recreate the wheel? They did a great job.
And to that point, you'll see later in the agenda a proposal to move forward with the Seminole project. It's on the consent agenda, but it also will emulate very closely the Tarpon Springs facility.
Any other questions?
Thank you all.
No.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Next item, under academic matters, study abroad 2016-2017, Ms. Kirsch.
Good morning, Chairman Oliver and President Law and members of the board. It's my great pleasure to be here this morning to provide you an update of our current study abroad offerings, but also to present for your approval our proposed programs for the 2016-2017 academic year. As you can see from this first slide, we have had great success this year with over 140 students, close to 150 students currently enrolled in our study abroad programs. That represents a 35% increase from last year. Many of our programs are still open, so we're expecting an uptick in that number. I want to also point out a few things. We have 15 programs this year in 13 different countries, and this represents six new countries, as you can see here, and two new academic programs in our study abroad portfolio. Of note, there are students participating in the International Model United Nations in the Czech Republic. There's the High School Service Learning Program in the Dominican Republic, where they will be helping school children in local communities. There is our first-time health sciences program to South Africa, and a collaborative partnership with USF St. Pete to Vietnam. I want to mention two other additional things. One of our students attending the program to Vietnam is a presidential scholarship. And this highlights the fact that study abroad is a complete collaboration between academic affairs, student affairs, business, financial services, legal, marketing, as well as the foundation. And without all of that coordination and support, we would not be able to have these successes today. Building on the success, as you see from the second slide, we're proposing for your approval these following programs for the 2016-2017 academic year. As you can see on this and in your board memo, there are 16 programs, 15 countries, 19 different faculty, and our programs are running in all semesters, fall, spring, and summer. Now, in line with our strategic plan, these new programs include several new ones that are diversifying not only our geographic reach, but our programmatic reach. Among the firsts included are the ones highlighted in this slide. The first nursing program to Colombia is with our new partner, Universidad del Bosque in Bogota, and this will include a student exchange. Well, not only our faculty and students go to Bogota, but we will be hosting students from Colombia on our Carruth Health Education campus. The first Honors College study abroad program will be our service learning to the Dominican Republic. Our first study abroad program in the music and MIRA degree programs will be in Cuba. And of course, this represents also the first time ever that we will be having a program in Cuba. And finally, our first program in Thailand is for our vet tech students who will be volunteering at an elephant sanctuary and learning about the plight of endangered elephants there. We hope that these proposed programs meet with your approval, and I will be happy to entertain any questions. Thank you for your support.
Wonderful.
Thank you.
Any questions before we do that?
Sorry.
I move that we accept the proposed study abroad programs for the years 2016-17.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Under strategic priorities, career preparation and placement, Dr. Krupp and Dr. Fry.
Good morning, Mr. Chairman, members of the board, Dr. Law. Jason Krupp, Director of Workforce Services with Dr. Bright, Provost of Tarpon Springs Campus. Pleased to give you an update on career preparation and placement. To give some context for our presentation, I wanted to first provide an overview of enrollment by degree type at the college. You can see the largest percentage of students enrolled are in an associate in arts degree program with 17,000 students last year. This is the transfer degree. This is a general education liberal arts intended to go on towards a bachelor's. So you go enter a bachelor's program as a junior, either at SPC or another college or university. Then the next largest enrollment is in our workforce programs. The AS degrees or associate in science degrees are less well known but highly valuable for our workforce. 37 associate science degree programs such as nursing, information technology, respiratory care, engineering technology. A large majority of these programs are high wage, high skill, high need in our area. Embedded within those associate in science degrees, we have 54 certificate programs, which are basically the technical skill, the courses that you need to get those technical skills. And then we have 21 bachelor's degrees. You see almost 6,000 students enrolled last year in those 21 baccalaureate. Those baccalaureate degrees are, originally the AS degrees were considered terminal degrees, but now they are transferable towards a bachelor's degree. So many of those bachelors are a pathway for our associate in science degree students. If you look at the number of graduates last year, we had over 3,500 credentials awarded in just the workforce area. We're not looking at associate in arts here. This is just the certificates, associate science, bachelor's, and our police and fire academy. So you see we have 3,500 going into the workforce, upskilling or entering the workforce for the first time. And if you look at the fall term and spring, the spring term is the numbers that have applied for graduation. So they're still applying as the semester goes on through the end of the term. So we expect to exceed last year's numbers this semester and through the summer. So one of the ways that we're, or two of the ways we're preparing students within the curriculum are through internships and industry certifications. It's been a strategic initiative for the past several years to embed these two items into the curriculum. So you can see we've grown internships and work-based learning over the years, and we expect to exceed that number this year. The picture there you see is one of our IT graduates. She, after doing her internship with the college, she got hired at Revel Systems, and she recognized the value of the talent pipeline that interns offer. And she has an ongoing relationship with the college now and hosts internships every semester and hires several of those on as well. The internship offers a great way to help. Many of the advertisements you see for jobs will say bachelor's degree plus 3 to 5 years experience. Well, a lot of employers still aren't aware of the associate science degree program and the value that they have. These students come out being able to do computer programming or networking and have the industry certifications. So the internship gives them a foot in the door and an opportunity, the employer's an opportunity to test drive them and see the value that they bring. The industry certification is another strategic initiative. We began really focusing in on that 2 years ago. In 2013-14, we had a small number of 48 reported. Last year, we had 546 reported. And these are bringing back dollars to the college from the state through incentive funding. Last year, we brought in about $350,000 additional revenues to the college because of that. We plan to exceed last year's numbers, and we're looking at about 600 by the end of next month. So here you see the placement report. Placement is defined as entering the military or continuing their education or employed in field. And you see the largest percentage employed in field in all three categories. Associate science having the highest placement rate, 93%. The certificate and vocational are the career, the academies such as police and fire, and then bachelor's degree. So our overall average is about 90% placement rate. Here we see the annual full-time salary of our graduates, and it's a nice staircase, a direct correlation with the amount of time it prepares to get the credential, starting with the shortest time of the applied technology diploma, that would be like our EMT program, and then all the way up to the bachelor's degree program. So we have a nice salary for our workforce graduates, and happy to report that within the state's funding model, as we heard earlier, we were ranked number one in the state among all the state colleges in the salary of our graduates. Dr. Bright's now going to talk about how some of the things happening on campus, the strategic initiatives to continue the growth of career readiness and placement of our students.
Thank you, Jason. With the approval of the reorg and the staffing structure of the career and advising model, we committed that all of our career and academic advisors will be certified as a career development facilitator. Not only for our career and academic advisors, but we also included other staff, student support staff. We included all advising managers, retention managers, disability resources staff, our veteran services staff, and also our career and outreach specialists to be a part of that training. This training demonstrates the college's commitment to providing and engaging students in that career conversation and exploration so they can actually identify a career. With the certification, we'll also be able to help students to properly advise them to get into the correct guided academic pathway to reach that career. As you can see on the screen, we currently have a total of 114 staff members. Each of them will get 120 hours of training individually, with a total over 13,000 hours of training. Next slide, please. This slide actually demonstrates some of our tools and services that we provide students. We provide these services to students face-to-face, but we also provide them online. Students have direct access to these services through their My Courses module. As you can see, some of the actual soft skills we do with preparing students for the professional world. We do resume workshops with students. They can actually come in and create resumes. They do cover letters, guided towards their careers. We do mock interviews. We also do LinkedIn photo shoots. As you see to the right, those are most recent December graduates. And the actual photos are actually done by the AS degree, the Photoshop program. Those students come to the campus and actually do those photoshops for LinkedIn. We've chose LinkedIn because now many employers are allowing students to use their LinkedIn accounts to upload applications. So we really believe we're putting our students at an advantage professionally. The bottom is actually what we're using, Burning Glass. This is like a search engine for students that can actually look and explore jobs locally, regionally, and nationally. Some of the numbers that you see there, they actually look at these jobs and compare them as far as salaries. As you see the numbers compared to the fall when we collect this data, we look for our spring numbers to increase drastically. We look to actually either be equal to what we did in the fall or better than our students accessing those services. Here is where we're scaling up our career services. We're very proud of what we're doing. As you can see, we've offered a total of 572 workshops, events, and classroom visits for a total over 15,000 students taking advantage of those workshops and activities to guide students towards their careers. Here we're very proud of the collaboration with the deans and our faculty. We wanted to be able to take our career services workshops and embed them into the curriculum, right in the classroom and also outside of the classroom. Many of the faculty members are doing a lot of out-of-classroom support, bringing their classes to our career services, where we're giving them workshops based on the menu of career services. There's a number of services that our staff are actually providing right in the classroom, but also as we're bringing them over to our career centers. As you can see, also we included on-demand career services webinars that students can do on their own. We're really proud of increasing our numbers as far as giving our students the advantage to be competitive once they leave us with credentials. As mentioned earlier, we're very proud of our enhancements that we've provided for our career centers. If you have not come to Tarpon Springs, please, I invite you to come and see the wonderful things that we're doing. But also, there's more of a commitment. As you heard earlier, Seminole is in the process of creating their career center, also with Clearwater. So we're very, very proud. I really believe, I think all of you will agree, that we're giving our students an advantage compared to others after they leave the college. Excellent. Any questions?
No, I would just, the only thing I would do is I would encourage anyone who hasn't been up to Tarpon to get in there and take a look at the new advising center as well as the career center. It'll knock your socks off.
I agree with that. Those comments.
Thank
great
you very much.
Great job. Thank you.
Thank you both.
Thank you.
Next item is the consent agenda, and I'll ask, as we typically do, is kind of take this as a group. Is there any items on the consent agenda that we need additional information on? All of that information is in the book. If there's no questions about any individual items, I'll take a motion to take that as a group.
I make a motion that we accept it as a group.
Second.
All in favor?
Is it real quick? And I don't know, the lease with the city of St. Pete, is that fourth, is that, that's not in the consent agenda, or is it?
Yeah, it is.
It is. I have some questions about that.
You're talking about the item D?
City of St. Petersburg Training Division lease agreement.
Yes, sir.
There's a Robert's Rules of Orders, you have to
Why don't we do this? Why don't we pull? I would move the consent agenda. Sans D.
I get it.
You can do whatever you want.
I got it.
Have to follow the guidance here. So if somebody moves to pull that item off the consent agenda.
I pull the agenda. I pull my motion for the consent agenda.
So we are. The motion is to pull item D for further discussion.
Yes.
But to approve items A, B.
Yes, sir.
All right.
I'm in my motion.
All in favor?
Aye.
Any opposed?
No. Now we take up D.
D, second for police department lease agreement.
Yeah, and I don't need a presentation. I fully read the lease, and I know what it's for. We're basically getting $4.50 per square foot every month, which market value of a vacant building, I really don't care. We're not making any money. We're probably, in my observation, making just enough to cover the ground expenses and liability. So we're not making anything. I want to make sure that this isn't going to cost us anything. In my former life, I would have wanted the college to bear all of the expenses, but I'm wearing a different hat now. So I guess my question, do we know what it's going to cost to bring it up to ADA compliance? Because right now it's apparently a vacant building, and we're going to bear the expense of bringing it up to full ADA compliance.
Yes, Mr. Foster, that work has actually already been completed. We completed that work with our in-house construction group.
Excellent.
And all of those fees are covered with general operating budget. It's all done, inspected, and ready to go.
Perfect. Mm-hmm. City's going to be responsible for custodial and garbage collection, but the college, 8.1.4, college is going to maintain all capital improvements, repairs, and upgrades to the building. I'd like to exclude repairs and upgrades to the building that the city makes. And my thought is, if it's just training, and I know what the existing training building looks like, it's just an office. If they're going to move evidence storage, that's a completely separate animal. You've got bodily fluids, you've got drugs, you've got all sorts of things, and I know they've got to move their evidence storage out of First Avenue North and put it somewhere. If this is going to become an evidence storage area, then it requires air filtration, HVAC, cages, refrigeration. I mean, it requires a lot. And so if that's the intent, I want it to be 100% at the city's expense, and I don't want the college to have any liability for maintaining those capital improvements or upgrades.
Mr. Foster, I'm Scott Fronowich. I'm the provost of the Allstate campus. to help you be more comfortable with this, their intent is the current storage evidence is going to be in a locker, current closet. Really, it's what it's going to be. It's going to have a camera system. That evidence locker, if you will, is going to be with two supervisors. No evidence of that has been assured to us that is going to be in there. What they're looking for is their street crimes unit are going to be using that particular area. And so if they're coming in and they're having paperwork or some sort of digital, they're going to store that there so it's not accessible to anybody else, and it's going to be under supervision of that. If it looks for clarity, and I totally respect your level of concern there, we can always ask for an addendum to make sure that that is not the case. But as of right now, we've been served through the chief all the way down to the current commanders that are going to be overseeing that type of evidence will not be there at all.
Okay, because I know that there's still a plan, because heck, there was back in my day, to tear down the facility on First. They got to move the evidence somewhere. And I know that there's a great agreement now with the Sheriff's Department in doing homicide investigations and evidence storage there. But the city still stores drugs and tissue samples, body. And right now this agreement permits the relocation of all of that, pretty much. It just it does say particularly evidence storage. If it's just street crimes, fine. I'd feel, I guess, a little more comfortable if we, if it was, if there was a little more clarity that, A, they're not moving their entire evidence operations to this facility, and B, that we're not, we have no responsibility to maintain capital improvements or upgrades made by the city of St. Petersburg. And then I'm fine. Again, we're not making a penny, but I don't want it to cost us anything either. We're good partners, and I love it, but we're not going to subsidize the city operation.
Mr. Chairman, can I suggest that we can do one of two things. We can bring it back next month if you want, or we can pass it and give us, take that guidance for us to amend the contract as appropriate for that, report back that it's been done, and move forward with a vote now.
Okay? I would just put in my motion that the contract be amended to meet those terms and that you approve it, Dr. Law, and we can move forward. Yeah, if that's okay with Mr. If that's okay with Mr. Sure. Foster.
I'll second that.
All approved.
Aye.
Any disapproved?
Thank you.
Thank you very much.
I have a tendency to read things like that.
I'm impressed.
Thank you.
Thanks.
All right. Item 8, there are no informational reports. Item 9, no public access or unagenda items. Item 10, which is in your book, under tab 10, the proposed changes to the Board of Trustees rule manual. There are three that have been submitted.
Mr. Chairman, I think you have to gavel
Do
us
to gavel
as a
this?
Hearing, yes. You have okay. to open the public hearing.
Right, that'll open, close the board meeting, I guess, and open the public hearing. There are three agenda items there that relate to, and I'll just read through these per the memo. Item 6H, X23-1.34, which is discrimination grievance rule. Proposed change will update the non-discrimination statement of the college to include pregnancy as a protected category. Item 2, 6H, X23-2.01, equal employment opportunity / affirmative action. The proposed change will revise the rule to reflect the current policy of the college and update the non-discrimination statement of the college to include pregnancy as a protected category. And the third, 6HX23-2.010, harassment and relationship policy and definitions. The proposed change will repeal the rule in accordance with Florida statutes, as its provisions are either no longer applicable, redundant, or have been incorporated into other rules, board rules and college procedures.
I move that, Mr. Chair, that we take up these proposed changes to our Board of Trustees manual.
Do I have a second?
Second.
All approved?
Aye.
Aye.
Any opposition? All right, with that, all those pass.
Thank you. Close it.
All right. And open the board meeting back up for the president's report.
Mr. Chairman, I need just a minute or two. We've already touched on the operating budget considerations from the legislature. There was almost no substantive legislation once we dispatched the concealed carry issue. We have a great piece of news, though. The Student Success Center for the St. Pete Gibbs campus is in the budget that was passed. $10 million this year with assurances of $10 million next year. We'll match with $5 million of our own, a 60,000 square foot facility that, think of what we've been building now, Midtown.
Nice.
So we're very, very pleased with that. Please say thank you to every member of the Pinellas delegation. It was the number one priority. They spoke in unison on this. Every one of them went to bat for us. If you are disposed to call the governor's office, now would be a good time to do that. Okay, we don't know which tack the governor will take. Will it be the veto tack or will it be the non-veto tack? But, you know, this project is very close to our heart. It's not a STEM project. We've dressed it up so that the career pieces are in the center. It makes a great deal of difference to us. So if you know somebody on the governor's immediate staff or the governor himself, please go ahead and express our thing. Thank you for your support on this. It has worked really well. Other than that, I think, Mr. Chairman, I think that will dispatch all of my responsibilities for my report.
Mr. Chair, just to follow up on that, Dr. Law, thank you. I had that on my notes. I missed the beginning part of the meeting. But we have done an excellent job as a team. Dr. Law, his team, has done an excellent job holding this place in the budget, working with multiple legislators from across the Bay Area, including Senator Lee, who's been a stalwart after came and visited and made sure that we stayed in there along with Senator Latvala and the rest of the delegation. Have done a great job holding this $10 million in the budget. I would tell you, Dr. Law, if you could, this may require a field trip for the board of a meeting with the governor so we can sit with him and explain him how important it is to the college. If board members would like to go, we should probably try to set that up so that we don't get a veto message on the other side of that, because it is in the PICO budget, but as you well know, it was not recommended. So we need to make sure that we keep him honest on this one, that we really need these dollars. And then the only other thing, Dr. Law, is I would say to any board members, I will say this, I entreat all of you, the new board members especially, to go around and visit these campuses so you can see the different communities we serve and how we serve them, we meet them where they are, so to speak, because they're very different. The Tarpon Springs campus is very different from Seminole, but we meet the needs of each community. So that's it. Thank you, Dr. Law. Thank you, everybody else.
Very good. Last item, next meeting, date April 19th, back here at Epicenter. And with that, we'll adjourn the meeting.
Thank you very much.